Now, we know that the minimum number of errors that can be incurred is L dimension of the hypothesis class. Now, can we come up with an algorithm which also ensure that I do not make no more than these mistakes, that is L dimension of H. Is the question clear? I know that that is unavoidable. Maybe in the worst case I have to make L dimension of mistakes. Can I now aim for an algorithm which actually makes no more than this mistake? If I can do that, then that is the optimal algorithm, right? It is only going to make the mistake which is unavoidable and it is not going to make any mistakes. Okay, now how to come up with an algorithm? Whether such a, there exists an algorithm. So, we will just discuss one algorithm which indeed does that job, called standard optimal algorithm. So, you just notice that like when I computed the little dimension, L dimension, I computed for the simple case, right, where there are only d points there and there are d hypotheses, for which it was almost easy to compute. But I kind of avoided computing L dimension for the case where it has large number of hypotheses, right. So, it is because it needs 2-bit work out, it is not like as simple as this. I mean, finally, when you work out, you will feel that that is not much. So, what is in general the case is computation of L dimension is not easy. If I give you arbitrary hypothesis class, it may be pretty computationally involved. How to, so how, so I defined, okay, the maximal depth D, if there exists a binary graph which will be shattered, then I call it as L dimension. Well, that is the definition, but how to compute it, right? Like right when you and I are computing the simple example, you are thinking, okay, why not something, if I go further down, take graph a bit more depth, will it be shattered or not? So, we have to exclude those cases, right? Like we can, we to understand what is L dimension, okay, only I can shatter up this point and not beyond this point. So, that all these things could be pretty computationally involved, but when we are going to write down this, we do not care about computational aspects. Okay, we just care about as long as they exist, that is fine, and as long as our definitions are consistent and make sense, fine. Computationally, maybe to compute simple hypothesis, it may be taking on several GPUs, it may be taking 4-5 days, weeks, months, years, I do not care. As long as it is well defined and it exists, we should be fine. Now, so this one standard optimal algorithm, which we will argue that So you see that this algorithm is almost same as Hollywing algorithm, except for the fact that here you are going to compute the L dimension of the hypothesis class corresponding to the one which predicted label 0 and label 1, and then make your prediction based on that. Okay, let's understand this. So at any given time, you are maintaining this hypothesis class, and you are going to partition your hypothesis at time t into two parts. One set of all hypotheses which are assigning label, let's say r equals to 0, and another set of hypotheses which is to 1. You have two hypothesis class there. So one set saying 0, one set saying 1. In the Hollywing algorithm, what we did, we just said a label which corresponding to the one which has the largest number of hypotheses in this, right? But here, instead of that, we compute the L dimension of the hypothesis class of both my hypothesis class, and then take the one which has the largest L dimension here, okay? And then going to predict according to this. So in all this case, it may happen that sometimes the two hypothesis class I have here, we may end up with the same L dimensions for them, in which case you are going to break the try arbitrarily. You are going to say if they are both of them same L dimension, you are going to just say either 0 or 1, okay? Either you toss a coin or say that, or it is up to your discretion, whatever you want to do. And then you receive YT, and then you are going to retain only those which are making a correct prediction on your correct predictions on your given observed point XT, rest you are going to throw away. You can show that this algorithm is optimal, in the sense, I am just going to state this. That is, even this algorithm, it is guaranteed that it is not going to make no more than L dimension number of errors. That means, actually what I know, that this guy is also lower bounded by this, so it is going to make the minimum number of mistakes, okay? So I am just, so as a corollary to this, I can, based on my lower bound, I can actually say that this guy is XL equals to L dimension of H for this particular algorithm. Okay, I will just, the proof is also straightforward, but I will skip that part. So finally, we are completing the loop for the case of realizability condition, when the reliability assumption holds, right? We have first showed that for the realizability assumption, what kind of bounds we can get. Then we ask for what is the best bound we can get. Then we establish that what is the minimum bound we can expect, right? That we shown through a lower bound. Then we are showing that lower bound is achievable through this one. So this is the best, like any algorithm, this is the best it can guarantee. It can't guarantee anything more than this, when the realizability assumption holds, okay? Now, why should realizability assumption hold, okay? Yeah, so that is what, like I have skipped the proof of this. We are just saying that if you are going to choose this YT hat based on the one which has the largest L dimension, you will be ending up ensuring that you will be not making this many number of mistakes. Okay, fine. what about what happens if there is no fixed hypothesis in my class according to which the labels are generated, okay. Now, what will be my strategy and what will be my evaluation criteria, okay. So, first, if there is no hypothesis in my hypothesis class according to which my true labels are generated, can you guarantee a finite bound on any of your algorithm? Like whatever algorithm hypothesis you are going to choose, it is not necessary that the labels are going to come from that. It could be coming from, labels could be coming from some hypothesis which is outside your hypothesis class. So, because of that, there is no way like you can guarantee that you will stop making mistake after some point. You may still want to guarantee that you want to still want to minimize the number of mistakes you are going to make. So, in that case, now we have to see what kind of evaluation criteria we are going to set up and how we can minimize that, how we can do best on that. Okay, now we are looking to unrealizable case. So, by just unrealizable, I am saying that there a hypothesis generates the label need not be in the my hypothesis class H. So, that is this H star which generates my label need not be in my hypothesis class H. So, then in this case, now the first question is how we are going to set up our evaluation criteria, how I am going to evaluate myself, how good I am doing. All I can do is while learning, I can only use hypotheses that are coming from this hypothesis class, okay. But the true labels could be generated from a hypothesis which is outside. Then how I am going to measure my performance against, okay. So, earlier when H star was included in my hypothesis class H, I aim to quickly identify that and always play that, identify quickly that and always play that, right. If you can quickly identify, always play that, you are making no mistakes. Now, anyway that H star is not there in my hypothesis class. Now, what I would like to do is, what is that single hypothesis in my hypothesis class, if I keep playing throughout, that would have given me the smallest number of mistakes. I do not know a priori which is the one which is going to give the minimum number of mistakes a priori. But I want to do as close as to that, okay. So, let us suppose I kept on telling you, okay, in round 1 this was x 1 and this was corresponding label y 1, in the x 2 y 2 like this, okay. And these labels are generated by this H star, but this H star does not belong to my capital H. Now, all you can use is hypothesis from this hypothesis class H, right. Which one among this you would have liked to apply on this? Let us say you have after observing all of this.
One which gives minimum number of.
Right. So, you would like, okay, you will take first take one hypothesis from this and apply it on all H1, H2 thing. And see at how many point it made mistakes. That is the number of mistakes you get for the first hypothesis, and you can do it for all the hypotheses. And you will see someone which has made the smallest number of mistakes. You would have liked to ideally start applying that one right from the beginning, right? Because that is the one which is. So, here now you have the advantage of hindsight. You have observed all the things, and at this point you are seeing what is the best I should have done. Now, I am going to take that as my evaluation criteria. I am going to take that hypothesis which has done best on this hypothesis class is my benchmark, but I a priori do not know that, right, because I have not seen this. This is, I am in an online setting, I am not in a batch setting. If I start from, if I start making predictions, how much errors I am going to make, compared to that hypothesis which is the best in hindsight. Okay, that we are going to express as follows. Okay, fix first hypothesis. So, what is the first part here? Yt hat is what you predicted. Yt is what? Been revealed. So, Yt hat minus Yt is the mistake you are going to make, right? We are in a binary setting. So, over t rounds, so this is the mistake you have made. Suppose you happen to apply the same hypothesis H in every round. By applying this hypothesis H, this is the number of mistakes you have made. Okay? Now, this is basically you are comparing yourself against a fixed hypothesis H. Okay, now what I will do? I will take the worst of things. I am going to because I do not want to be dependent on a sequence, right? Like I do not care about which particular sequence I have been observing. I want to give this guarantee for all possible sequences. So that is why I am going to take this supremum over all of this. Okay, what is this now? If I have to play a single hypothesis throughout my interaction with the environment, this is how that is going to give me this much of errors for all possible sequence, and this is what I would have incurred according to applying my own algorithm. So, Yt hat is given by your own algorithm. This is what you are going to incur if by your algorithm, this is what you are going to incur by playing a fixed hypothesis.
Which gives the minimum number of mistakes?
No, I do not know, whatever. I do not know, I am not saying that gives me the minimum number of mistakes. It is just one hypothesis from that.
Belonging to H.
Belonging to H. And let me call this as so this R, your algorithm A, which is going to predict Yt hat in round T, and in n rounds, this is what you are going to incur. So you think it like this. Suppose you give me a sequence that you have been faced. So let's say when you are going to face an environment, this is the sequence you observed. In that, this is the number of mistakes you incurred. This is the number of mistakes incurred by hypothesis H. And this is the difference between you and the hypothesis H. Now I am looking at the maximum difference of this.
But the Yt hat that we have got,
yeah,
that is also we have got from some hypothesis.
No, this is by your algorithm. This is where you are going to use one of the hypotheses in each round, right? You are going to but what you are going to do, this your Yt hat is coming from this, right? In your SOI algorithm, it is coming like this. in Hardening algorithm, it is coming in a different way. Whatever it is, I'm just writing it as yt hat. And I have now looked at the worst case. How is this one? Yeah, because I'm looking at the number of rounds, right? I said that my interaction is for n number of rounds, and my sequence length is also n here. That's what the x1, y1 all the way up to xn, yn. I have looked at n interactions. If you are going to change n, the summation will also be larger. Okay. Now, what I want to now look into this is, I am going to now call it as the regret I have for not using hypothesis H all the time. This is what you get, the number of mistakes you incur. Had you played H, this is what you would have gotten. You are comparing yourself with this. So you are basically saying how well I am doing, or how I am doing compared to the case where had I played H throughout. My benchmark here is playing the same hypothesis throughout. Now, as you said, this hypothesis is here need not be the best one. Okay, I don't know which one in my hypothesis class does the best job. Okay, I want to now compare my performance against that best hypothesis. So, how to take that into account? Now, I am going to define my regret as supremum of this guy. So, this is the regret I am going to incur if I have been playing H, right? If I have played a good H, this quantity is going to be smaller, right? Because if I am using a good H, it is going to make a smaller number of mistakes. So, that is why I am taking supremum over all H. Okay, so alternatively, you can just before writing this step, I am going to do this. So, what I am doing, I am looking, instead of this particular H, I am looking for a H which minimizes this quantity. In a way, I am looking at my best hypothesis which gives me the smallest value, right? So, if I write here, this H is now a function of this hypothesis, sorry, this sequence, right? The best one, but I wanted to not define it in this fashion. So, this is minus of inf, right? If I pull this outside this inf, it becomes sup over h. But now, if I write sup over h here, this h is still a function of this sequence, the best sup here. Okay, okay. So, I don't want it to be depend on H. So, the way we are defining it is, we are just defining it as like this. So, okay, fine, whatever you can ponder on this finally, but are you convinced that the benchmark we are setting is the single best hypothesis against that I would have liked to use compared to how much I am going to incur when I am using my algorithm. I am just comparing whatever algorithm I am going to use, how it fares against a hypothesis which gives me smallest number of mistakes. I do not know what it is, but a priori, but I want to perform as close as possible to that one. And this is characterized, this is capturing that, and we are going to call this as, now because we have taken sup over h, now this is only function of n here. Suppose my realizability condition holds, okay, what would be this term here? It is going to be 0, right, because there exists one h star which is always going to make a prediction, and this term is going to be 0. But now I do not know, I have removed that condition, right, because of that this guy need not be necessarily 0. Even the best guy I have in my hypothesis, it is going to possibly make mistakes, but fine, that is what I can afford to, and I am going to compare my performance against the best I can afford or I have access to, and this we are going to call it as regret. In this setup, we will keep defining different notions of regret throughout, but in this case this is how we are defining our regret. Did I make any such assumption in defining this? I did not make any such assumption here. Or if the finite hypothesis class is not finite, does anything break down here in my definitions? Is everything still make sense? As long as these things are consistent and not violating any of our consistency checks, that is fine. So here nothing is being violated. Okay, now fine, this is what you have defined your regret to be. This is your performance criteria, this is what you are going to set your criteria, evaluation criteria as. Now what you want, what you want this regret to be, small, large, small, how small? 0, can you guarantee 0? Why? Yeah. No, only it can be 0 is this quantity is, I mean, for the best hypothesis I have, I am doing similar to that. Now we get to the notion of learnability here. Remember, how did you define learnability in the realizable case? We said that as long as the number of mistakes I can bound by some finite number, then we said that hypothesis class is learnable by algorithm A. What is the notion of learnability here? Okay, we say that, so actually I should also write this as, this is now you are learning this hypothesis class, right? So I am just also, it is important to mention what is the hypothesis class we are learning. So this is R capital H. Now we are going to say that this hypothesis class H is learnable if my regret is sublinear. And what is the definition of sublinear? If you are going to divide this quantity, the regret H R A H by N by N, and let N go to infinity, this goes to 0. Okay, what is that ratio telling RA divided by N. So, RA was regret over N round, right? When you divide it by N, that is regret per round. If you are learning, that means you are, if you are figuring out which is the best hypothesis in your hypothesis class, you should be eventually make lesser and lesser mistakes, right? And you should be start doing as good the best hypothesis class in your hypothesis class would have done. If you do this, you should be incurring kind of the same amount of mistakes that the best hypothesis class in your hypothesis class has made. Because of that, maybe as for some n, this could be some finite number, but if you are going to start looking at that difference beyond some number, that should be smaller, right? Okay, let's say this is for n, right? Let's split it into two parts. I am going to now take this n as n1 plus n2. First n1 rounds and subsequent n2 rounds. Maybe the initial n rounds you don't have any clue what is happening. You will be some making mistake, but you are kind of figuring out what is happening. But later in the next n2 rounds, you have kind of figured out what is happening. You expect yourself to make lesser mistakes, right? And maybe like after further rounds, you expect to make lesser and lesser mistakes. Because of that, if you look into this summation here, maybe for the first n terms, this is some number, but in the next n2 rounds, you expect this difference to shrink and also further shrink, right, as n goes. So that is why if you are really doing figuring, your algorithm is smart and it is figuring out what's happening, it is eventually going to, as n increases later in the subsequent part, it's not going to incur too much of penalty here. It will be doing as good as the best hypothesis class in your algorithm would have done. So because of that, we, if this condition holds, like you will see in this case, you are on an average, when n is large, you are doing as good as your best hypothesis in your hypothesis class would have done. Is that, do you understand, like by letting this n go to infinity, this going to 0, it exactly means that. So this is why we call, if this condition holds, this hypothesis class is learnable, because if you give me sufficient number of rounds, I am kind of figuring out what is the best hypothesis and I am incurring lesser and lesser mistakes. Okay. So you will see, like as I said, you will be seeing different notions of regret as we go along this course. Now we are, our next step is to see what kind of bounds we can give on this, what kind of guarantees we can give, and always we will ask the question, is this the best guarantee I can give? Okay, like the way we did it for the realizable case. So note that this, if I can come up with an algorithm A such that this condition holds, then it's called learnable.